This is an air pump from the 19th century. It's a device that removes the air inside the glass bell chamber, creating a vacuum seal for doing experiments. And it's currently on display in the space outside the gallery where the Huntington's iconic portrait of the Blue Boy typically hangs. Although he is not currently on view. Instead, you'll find a portrait of a young gentleman by Kehinde Wiley. We commissioned Wiley to paint a response to our iconic Gainsborough portrait. So, for the moment, Blue Boy himself was free to travel on loan to the National Gallery, visiting London again after a 100-year hiatus. And the National Gallery was kind enough to agree to a reciprocal loan. And that's why the air pump is there. It's part of the exhibition, Science and the Sublime, a masterpiece by Joseph Wright of Derby, which combines 15 objects from the library and art collections with the borrowed painting, An Experiment on a Bird in the Air Pump. In the painting, an itinerant scientist is demonstrating the nature of air by putting a live bird inside a vacuum. By removing the air from the glass chamber, the bird will perish. By letting the air back in, the bird survives.
One of the great masterworks of the Enlightenment, one of the most significant paintings on a history of science theme, one of my favorite paintings, which I first saw over a decade ago in London at the National Gallery. It stuck with me because experiments with the air pump are perhaps the most important experiments done related to physics in the 17th and early 18th century.
There's a clue to the significance that the artist places on the act of witnessing an experiment with an air pump. It's on the table, in the shadows of the candlelight, two Magdeburg hemispheres. They also appear on the open page of a rare book from the library's collection that's displayed next to the painting. It's Otto von Guericke's 1672 publication documenting his development of the first air pump and the discoveries that it revealed.
He creates what are known as Magdeburg hemispheres. It's basically a copper globe with two hemispheres that can be placed together to create a ball of copper. You place a seal between them, a pad of leather soaked in some kind of an oil, and it creates a seal between the two. You remove the air, and even teams of horses can't separate the hemispheres one from another. So when von Guericke does first do this experiment, he does it multiple times, and most notably, as in the image which is shown in our exhibition, it is before a group of dignitaries. This is before the royalty of the Holy Roman Empire. But this was the book that was produced under Otto von Guericke's eye that he used to announce the discoveries that had been made with the air pump and that really showed people that this could be replicated elsewhere. And it really is a sumptuous volume with this full-page spread of the depiction of the experiment with the horses pulling at the hemispheres in either direction. And it's showing a moment in time that actually occurred. And it's being used to communicate something particular about how this experiment was really done in front of people. And there were witnesses there. They saw this really extraordinary thing happening with this phenomenon that is really strange and somewhat inexplicable by the current natural philosophy of the era that dates back to the ancient world. So showing experiments that people would have seen, that would have been witnessed, I think was a new technique in order to convince people about particular things that were happening in nature. So I find it to be a really extraordinary moment in the early modern era. How do you go about convincing people and building consensus on a question, for instance, about whether or not vacuums can exist in nature? In the 17th century, you needed a consensus among gentlemen, and there's were the opinions that mattered. Today, things are different. You build consensus among a particular group of professionalized scientists, but the question about how to convince people of the importance of scientific discovery, we are still faced with these questions. Disinformation is still out there, spreading your ideas, even though we have the internet, it's still profoundly difficult. So in that respect, there's just a great deal of overlap between this earlier era and what we experience today.